Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Coming Rain, written by Stephen Daisley and read by Paul English. The dedication reads, to Sylvia. The father lit the candle at the kitchen fire, put it where it shouldn't light the boy's face, and watched him. And the child knew he was watching him, and pretended to sleep, and so pretending, he slept. Henry Lawson, A Child in the Dark and a Foreign Father. The dingo ran as if she had been here forever. Loose-jointed, her tongue wet and long, and eyes nonchalant as she travelled, ears forward and nose taking in the river of yonder grey coming to her as she crossed a clearing and paused among carrick bush, looked back to where she had come from. The last of the day's sun and the first of the four moons rising above the bloodwoods. The grey kangaroo, upwind of her, grazing quietly across a long, flat valley fringed with desert oak. They were deliberate, selecting and nibbling the beardy grasses, their slow, graceful feeding in the twilight. They moved through saltbush and into a grove of long-leafed paperbarks. The bitch flattened, laid her ears back, and watched. She lifted her nose to the horizon and the last of the sun lines, second moon coming. If she was to have meat this night, she would need to act immediately. She came out of the smoke bush slowly at first, then sprinting to close on the mob, and was among them, ranged alongside, watching their panic as she harried them, searching out what she wanted. A young doe carrying Nyanyi in her pouch collided with Balga, a little grass tree, and lost her footing. She rolled over and righted. The face and front feet of the Nyanyi came out of the pouch. The mother seemed to stand on her head as she aligned herself, saving her baby. She turned and bounded desperately behind the scattering mob. The dingo raced to flank them. They veered from her and she dropped back to make her kill. The mother with her Nyanyi still lagging behind the main mob, frantic to catch up. The dingo closed and balanced again, turned into the run of the yonga, her head towards the long throat, laid her ears back and launched into her killing attack. The wide-eyed kangaroo flung herself away to the left, skittering through paperbarks, paused in the long grass and shook her head as if to get her bearings. It was another few seconds before she seemed to register where she was and turned to follow her clan. The dingo somersaulted when she fell, rolling over and over in the dirt. She lay on the ground, her sides heaving. Then she sat up, closed her mouth and stood, circled the droppings and urine, rubbed her face and neck in the scat and rolled over in it, shook, got to her feet and gave a barking howl, listened to the yonga leaping through the brush, their strong scent like water, an easy path for her to follow. It was just dark when she closed on them again, the third moon three quarters high and bright. This time, it was in open ground, a man-made clearing, a road, and prickly dryandra bushes. The yonga, nervous now along the verge between the bushes, tentatively grazing on new grass. Again they smelled and heard her, gave off the loud clicks and bounded away. She feinted left to bunch them, and just as quickly swung to the right flank to turn them into heavier scrub, all the time searching out the mother carrying the Nyanyi. It was then that the headlights came on down the road, great yellow-white lights running through the night. She immediately abandoned her hunt, turned from the monstrous presence, and ran at a sharp angle from the road into the scrub. As she ran, there was a great thump, the terrible lights colliding with her prey. She stopped, lay down, and waited, listening to the voices. One of the lights had gone out. Men were talking to each other through the trees. Young man, old man. She saw dust rise through the remaining light and clouds crossing the moon. It was silent for a long time before she approached where the noise had come from. Almost morning. Sister sun coming up. Lou saw the woman walking out of the ocean at Cottesloe Beach. She was bending forward, scooping up handfuls of seawater and throwing them in front of herself. This fine woman, staring at him, at his big hands, white arms, and body whipped with cuts from the thorns, saltbush, and spinifex. Christ! Another set of waves came in, pushing her up and forward, and she lifted her arms and elbows to keep balance, stepped out of the water. The tide was being sucked back into the ocean, stripping the sand from beneath her feet. The constant sound of the small waves breaking on the beach. He was just 21 and couldn't swim. She put her head to one side and removed the rubber swimming cap. Damp brown hair fell to her shoulders. "Do you want something?" The black woolen costume had gathered close into her, and seawater was running down between her legs. Instead of speaking, he looked away to the sharknet pylon in the sea, a boy, long-armed, up on the concrete shoulder, holding the iron pole. Another crouched to dive off. They were black against the sky. Someone was calling from the new car park.
"Is that you down there, young Mr. McLeod?"
He called Lou's name as if he was announcing a runner in the Melbourne Cup. An older man, barefoot, walking awkwardly across the white sand. He raised a hand to block the sun. Lou waved at him. A smile broke out on his face.
"Painter! Here, mate!"
The old man approaching them was wearing a blue Jackie Howe shearer's singlet. Unshaved face. A bald head worn brown in the sun, covered in scars and odd bumps. Both ears were lumped, cauliflowered, and his left ear was much smaller. The nose broken so many times, there was no bridge left. He had big, wrinkled hands covered in tattoos of birds and stars. Strong, don't-touch-me arms, veins stood in his biceps. Spiderwebs on both elbows. Forearms showed thick blue outlines of a ship in full sail, and a naked woman in high heels with her hands behind her head, elbows like a bottle opener. Mary. A heart with an arrow through it. His name was Painter Hayes, and he was squinting at them in the glare of the sunlight coming off the sand. Opened his mouth to smile.
"Jesus, this sand is hot. And white as you like. Go blind," he said.
The woman in the woolen bathing costume spoke to him. "How do you do?" Painter nodded to her.
"Not bad. You?"
She stepped back.
"Fine, thank you."
"Why did we come here again, son?"
Painter, lowering his voice, speaking to Lou, but he kept looking at her.
"For a swim."
Lou folded his arms. A muscle in his jaw flexed.
"That surf patrol is marching over here like they want to rescue someone. And they are not fucking singing 'Come to me, Jesus,' neither,"
Painter said. And looked away to his left.
"They got ropes on their heads before. Walking about the show like they own the fucking place."
He touched his nose with his thumb. Nodded to say, "I see you there, and sorry, missus, I know the language." Wide, strong wrists he had. Shearer's wrists. Fighter's hands. Lou reached out his hand towards her to introduce himself. He had found his voice in the apology and presence of the other man.
"My name is Lewis McLeod. I'm a shearer. We just got in from Mrs. Anderson Darcy's place. Been shearing the rams. Me and Painter Hayes here. Tupping soon. That's why the rams now, see?"
"Sorry about him. Look at me. He's not right in the head."
She said nothing, looking at him as if he was a lunatic. Would not take his hand. He kept speaking.
lot of them thorny bloody merinos covered in the spinifex and saltbush. All through the wool, the wrinkly-necked bastards. Cut you apart.
The water had stopped running off her. She watched him and still did not accept his introduction.
You came down for a swim?
I did. Came down. Didn't expect to see you. Never been here before.
She was nodding.
Mrs. Anderson Darcy's. Tupping?
Son, Painter said. Come on, we better go. Stop talking to her. Oh no, look out. They're here.
Three muscular young men stood there with their arms folded over their chests, their feet firmly in the white beach sand, red and yellow skullcaps on their heads tied up under the chin with strings.
What are you doing here?
One of the lifeguards asked, his face all red, white zinc on his nose. Lou pointed at the ocean.
Maureen,
a lifeguard said,
don't talk to these blokes. They are just no-hopers. They don't even belong here. Look at them.
Painter spoke to the red-faced man.
We were just leaving. On our way. Come on, son. Cut it out. I never been to the bloody beach in my life. You neither. Fucking beach. Mr. Jesus, where are you now? Why would you want to lie out in the sand anyway? Fucking cook.
Watch your mouth, old man,
one of the lifesavers said.
There is a lady present, and this is not a sewer.
Painter glanced at him and nodded.
No, no, Lou said. Now hold on a minute, mate.
Wide shoulders turning. Maureen sniffed, shrugged, and looked back to the ocean.
I don't know.
Groups of bathers had stopped splashing and were standing still, staring at them. Blue and white striped beach umbrellas tilted towards the sun. Frowning mothers holding up towels and little children running to them with chubby, outstretched arms. The pylon divers also stopped and were looking in their direction, leaning out to one side, holding the pole. Painter looked at Lou.
Don't, he said. I mean it, son, don't. Oh, no.
Lou stepped forward and pushed the lifeguard who had been speaking to him.
Fuck off!
The lifeguard fell back, and another lifeguard ran in and shoulder-charged Lou.
Fair bump, play on!
He yelled, turned and snarled. Lou fell backwards into the sand. He was playing football. Now they were fighting. Lou was on his back, arms and legs waving like an upturned turtle. He was trying to get up. Somebody else stood above him and swung both fists at his head. Hit him on the cheekbone once and in the mouth, forehead and nose. He saw Painter stepping over and pushing away the man who'd been punching his face. There was a roaring of voices as the old man moved forward and knocked one of the surf rescue blokes down, turned as he was hit from behind, covered up, blocked, and hit another with a combination of punches. Old man moving like a good fighter, sound as a bell of brass, but step into your punches, son, and no cursing nor profanity when you box, I will not have it. The old trainer, Mr. Kilpatrick, speaking to him yet.
Fine, fine, but keep your hands up and be aware of yourself as you move above the canvas. Do you hear me? Above, and not on or about the canvas. You come to bearing close to the gentleman, Mr. Egan, the American Irish. A prince in the ring, and no doubt about it.
Two straight rights, double jab. Step away, left hook, and down goes another lifesaver on his red and yellow ass. Painter blew air and snot from what was left of his nose and danced to his left, hands up.
Yep, that'll do. Good. Wait on now, boys. My hands are not what they were, and I need to see them.
He coughed, and his bottom lip rode up onto his top lip for a moment. He allowed it and pulled his chin in, waved his right hand up and down as if in pain. All the time, he studied them.
Hurts!
You ugly old bastard!
One of the lifesavers said, fingers holding his bleeding nose, bent over and backing away.
You just broke my nose!
You got any wet paper bags, boys?
Painter, smiling.
I couldn't punch me way out of one if you paid me. Not a single one. Would you ever look at me? Naked! Old as a rock!
Lew, on all fours, blood streaming from his nose and mouth, and about to stand. Becoming giddy and still seeing white sand kicking up. Got to his feet, staggered to one side. Noticed the woman, Maureen, had walked off a few yards, folded her arms, and was watching them all.
Run, son!
Painter says to him over his shoulder.
Go on now! Get on up out of it!
Lew began running in the soft white sand, paused, and looked back. Painter had stepped away from the lifesavers and was once again appealing to them.
Come on, you young blokes!
His big hands back on his hips, stars and birds, love on one set of fingers, smile on his face, skin smeared off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.